recording. Grant, can you confirm again?
Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, perfect. Thanks, Grant. Grant is it's my personal confirming person, whatever. So like I said, today's seminar is going to be about the penalty corner. Real quick, who I am. My name is Roel van Maastricht. I am the director of high performance for Field Hockey Alberta. I'm also the head coach for UFC Dinos. As you might hear, because of my dialect, I'm from the Netherlands. I was raised in the youth academy of Hockey Club Den Bosch, and I currently live in snowy Calgary. Before we get into the details, I want to give a big thanks to Coaching Hockey. You can see the website on the screen. Coaching Hockey is a field hockey resource that I use a lot. If you want to go deeper into tactics, if you want to, they provide really deep analysis on tactical systems. In this case, I used some of their penalty corner analysis. Big thanks to Coaching Hockey for making all their analysis public. We're going to start with a video. It's a video from a game, Amsterdam against Bloemendaal. Two clubs in the Netherlands. What we'll see is that Amsterdam is attacking the right. Bloemendaal is defending the right. Yes, I'm correct.
Can you be quiet?
I don't know who that was, but please put your sound on mute, because I'm expecting you were not talking to me. I hope. So we have a game, Amsterdam against Bloemendaal. There is something that I see in the behavior of the defenders, but I'm curious about what you guys see.
Wij wonnen ze er 5 en die pijnlijke van vorig jaar zat er.
Here's the ball. Beautiful pass to the white player over there. So I'll show it again, and I'll pause it, which moment I think is important. For the people that were in last week's seminar about circle defense, like, talk about losing your player, but. So it's mainly now about the behavior of this player. So the white player over here has the ball. And I'm curious to think what everyone thinks of that player. The way he's defending. And there's a penalty corner. Show it again. Here. So the ball gets passed. Ball is now with the white player on the top. And it's about behavior that the orange player has right now. And then in the end, so what do we think? What is the general opinion about what do we see? What is the orange defender doing? What is your opinion about the way that he defends in this case? Is he aggressive in his defending? Like this moment he realizes, ball is over here, ball is going to that player. This moment he realizes he lost his player. It's a good move from the white player. But what do we see in the behavior of the orange player? Is the orange player aggressive? Is he holding back? Is he flying in? Is he defending the hotline? Is he stepping away?
He was defending the hotline, but he was too passive because he has the defender behind him. Mm-hmm. And he was already forcing the guy out of the circle a little bit. Mm-hmm. So he could have pressed that a bit harder.
And why do you think that he's not aggressive.
Because you can see a stutter step there, and then he's not coming towards the man.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's standing stationary pretty much there.
Yeah. And what I see in this moment is that he goes backwards and forwards. Do we see that? So in my opinion, and I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure, is that he realized he's too late, what you're saying. He's standing inside the circle, and he should be closer to the player. But he's afraid at this point that he's going to get the ball on his feet because he realizes he's in the wrong spot. So the ball arrives there. He realizes he's too late. He wants to go for the tackle, but realizes he's in the circle and doesn't dare to commit to a tackle or to defense. And in the end, what we'll see is he loses his player again. Ball goes in front, and it goes on the foot of a player, and there's a penalty corner anyway. And that's one thing that I think is really important with a penalty corner is, yes, a penalty corner can score you goals, but a good penalty corner also makes it easier for offense. Because to be realistic, if we see the situation, it is a 2-7. Right now it's a 1-3, 1-5. Ball goes to the side. Well, there's a player over there too, but it's a 1-2, and there's one in the back over there. 3-1-2-3-4-5-6. So if we talk about de-escalation and the circle defense, what we did last week, it is not a good situation, but it's an absolutely manageable situation. But in this case, the fear of getting a penalty corner against in this moment creates a penalty corner because it leaves the attackers with more space. So at first I was going to ask the question, like, why is it important to have a good penalty corner? And I was expecting that everyone would say, well, you can score goals. But I think another thing why it is extremely important to have a good attacking penalty corner is to make it hard for the defenders to defend the circle. A good attacking penalty corner will leave more space for offense.
Wij wonnen ze er 5 en die pijnlijke van vorig jaar zat.
But what is a good penalty corner? Like I say, I just told everyone, a good penalty corner creates more danger, creates more space for offense. But what is a good penalty corner? In general, a penalty corner, if you get a penalty corner, you have a good penalty corner or a strong penalty corner, you get a goal every 3 or 4 corners. So 1 out of 4. 1 out of 3. If we're talking about straight shots, and we're going to talk a lot about straight shots in this seminar, in men's field hockey, a straight penalty corner, a straight drag flick, at international top level, is a goal, 1 goal out of every 3 corners. And in women's international field hockey, there's 1 goal out of every 4 corners. I'm not saying that we should score 1 out of every 3 corners, but we also got to realize that, yes, we are not at top international level yet, but we're also not against top international defenders. So for my teams in general, if I look at my Dinos team, I expect my team to score 1 out of every 4 corners. And I'm pretty sure that last year we had that. We had 1 out of 3, 1 out of 4. But that is always the aim of a penalty corner. In my view, there are 3 key components in a penalty corner. That is the injection, that is the stop of the penalty corner, and that is going to a shot or going to a variation. So we're going to walk through those three key components, and with the shot, we're going to look at the drag flick. There are, I'm first going to show this one. We'll see different kinds of injecting the ball. We'll just have a look at it. If you compare the different ways of injecting the ball, you'll see that all the shots I've used are people using different techniques. This one in really slow-mo. So we've seen, and especially in this shot, it's really clear, there are different techniques to inject a penalty corner. As we can see in this one, this player is way further off the ball. This player is closer to the ball. This player has the top of his stick pointing left. This player has the top of his stick more pointing straight towards the target. Completely different ways of pulling out. My belief is that there's different techniques possible. Within women's field hockey, we now even see the pulling out, which is almost a drag flick to the top of the circle and then a drag flick to the net, where people really walk up to the ball. And I don't believe that there's one technique wrong or that there's one technique right. It is important that it fits the player that injects the ball. I do think that there are some key components in injecting a ball. If I look at how we should inject a penalty corner, there are three key components in injecting the penalty corner. That is the pickup of the ball, that is the pull of the ball where we pull it towards the target, and there's the follow through, that's how we end the technique. And I've written down some points that I think that are essential in a good penalty, injecting penalty corner, or a good penalty corner pullout. One thing that I always ask my players when I'm coaching the injection is, are you comfortable? I see a lot of players forcing their body position in a certain position because that's how their coach told it. It needs to be 1 or 2 feet away from the ball. Your left hand needs to be over there. Your shoulders need to be like this. But in the end, my personal opinion is that it's really important to have a comfortable body position. If you're uncomfortable in your position, you're never going to use your power or your energy or put your energy in the ball to the max because you don't feel happy. So first of all, be comfortable in your stance. Change your stance so that it's as much in the coach's instruction as possible, but in a way that you feel comfortable. The next thing that I think is important with the pickup is that you're stable. If you are in a position and you're suddenly going to put a lot of energy in the ball or in your movement and you are not stable, there is a big chance that your body position will change during the pull phase. And when your body position changes too much or changes in an uncomfortable way during the pull, it's not going to be accurate. Next point is the most common mistake in injecting the penalty corner. And that is that people put the ball in place, they're getting their stance ready, they're comfortable, they're stable, they put their hook on the stick, and they keep looking at the ball. Yes, you need to look at the ball at first to make sure that your ball is in the hook. But the moment you actually go to the pull phase, you need to look at the target. You need to look where the ball is going because your hand-eye coordination will steer the ball to where you want it to be stopped. if your eyes are looking at the ball, your body's going to just pull the ball, and your body position needs to be so perfect and so extremely the same every time in order to get it to the exact same spot on the top of the circle. And that is extremely hard. And even when it comes to different fields, there's going to be a different pull. So what I always tell my players is check if the ball is in the hook. If it's there, there's no one coming in to steal your ball anymore. That is not allowed. So put the ball in the hook at the spot, look at the target, and really fix your eyes on the spot where you want to pull it. And talk that over with the stopper. Talk with the stopper over, okay, I'm gonna pull it over there. I'm looking over there. Maybe even let the stopper point out the spot where he or she wants the ball. But that's where we fix our eyesight. When we get to the pull phase, it is important that we make a weight shift from right to left. Another common mistake that I see is that a lot of people have all their weight on their left leg and they only pull the ball with their arms. So they only pull the ball with their arms. You lose a lot of energy where you're just trying to pull with your arms. So make sure that your stance is all right. So your stance is comfortable like it is here. And then there's gonna be a moment where his weight shifts from that leg to his left leg in order to make sure that the power also comes from his legs. The last thing which is important, and I'll show it here again, is there can be a little curve in the ball while we pull it here, but it is important that the last part, and we see with this player that it in and about comes from here, is straight. So when we go over it real slow, we see that right here it's pulling a little bit to the right, and we see a little change in direction here. It's pulling to the left more, and we see here that he changes his hands a little bit and that the ball goes to the right. And in, where is it? And in this one, it's even more clear, I believe. We see if we look on the left with this player, we see that he first pulls the ball more towards his body, and then he goes straight. So it's okay if you have a little bit of change in direction while you're doing the pull. However, you need to make sure that the end phase, that there's at least, let's say, 10 centimeters of the ball going straight towards the target where you don't change your hands anymore. So that's what we see over here. When we're looking at the player on the left, he's pulling the ball a little bit towards his feet, but by now, we can see a clear angle change over here, so it's pulling towards, and at this point we see that he's putting all the aim in and he's pulling it straight towards the target, and it's a perfect pull. And the last thing that I think is important in injecting the penalty corner is that we move through the position of the ball, so we don't pull and stay in place. But we step forward while we do that. And I'm going to try one thing real quick. Grant, is the white screen in the middle or not?
The what, sorry?
Do you see? Oh, wait, I've already sold it. Forget it. Thanks. Thanks, though.
No problem.
Okay. So here we see it again. We see the pool. What we're going to see is that he's looking at the ball. When he's going to pull it, he's going to look up. See, this is the moment. He checked if the ball is in the right spot. He looks up to the target. He's going to start his pull. We see that he's shifting his weight. Weight goes from right to left. Moves through the ball. And a beautiful pull. Any questions on injecting the ball? No questions. Any people who like to do it differently?
I find it like I never look right at the top of the circle while I'm pulling.
I know.
So I find that I look at the circle at the beginning, like, and then I look back at the ball. I know, like the same way when you're in the D and you try to shoot, like, you know where the goal is.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I might try it differently and see what happens, but.
No, I know you, Nora, and I know how you pull out, and there's nothing wrong with that. My suggestion is to at least try it a couple of times when you're looking at the target, because when we get to a point where the higher level you'll end up, and you get to a point where the stopper is gonna switch like 1 or 2 meters to the right or to the left on the last moment in order to get around the first runner, it is really hard to adjust your pull. So I'm not saying it's wrong and not looking at the top, but at least give it a try a couple of times in your next practice to look at the target, because when you get to an even higher level and people start switching or switching castles or moving castles on the top of the circle, it's easier when you're looking at the target.
Okay, I'll give that a try. Thanks.
No problem. Trapping the penalty corner. For me, the most important part is keeping your eyes on the ball. Sometimes I see players coming in, they're ready, and they, because the ball is coming straight towards them and they're trying to stop with the reverse stick, they look at the zone where the ball is coming, or even look at their stick. But it's really important in this case to focus your eyes on the ball, because again, your hand-eye coordination is gonna adjust that minimum hand movement in order to stop the ball better. So it starts, and I'm afraid I don't have a really good example here. Maybe this one. Here we see one of the Argentina women, and you can see that her eyes are focused on the ball even before the ball is at her stick. So she's looking at the ball and she's really following the ball with her eyes until it hits her stick. So don't pick up the ball with your eyes halfway through the circle or look at your stick and hope it hits your stick, but make sure when you are that stopper on the circle, you focus your eyes on the ball when it's in the hook of the person injecting the ball. Another thing that I think is important is to keep our weight on the front of our feet. It is important to relax your arms. Your arms are like a spring which stops the ball. If you have your arms stretched, it's gonna bounce off. If you relax your arms, it's gonna come into your stick and you can stop it. And it is important to press your stick on the ground. Press it firmly on the ground with relaxing arms to make sure the ball doesn't go underneath or the ball doesn't go over top. So here we have some examples. You'll see small differences in where they stop the ball. This is Jamie Dwyer, former best player of the world. You'll see that he stops it a little bit further outside the circle. He might be the best player in the world, but he's not the best stopper in the world, because to be honest, preferably I would have loved it closer to the edge of the circle. The other thing that we see is that Jamie in this case traps it a little bit left of his foot. And I believe the Argentina girl that we're going to see in a second again does that too. See a little bit more left of her foot. But I think this is the best stopper I've seen on the internet so far. It's another guy from Australia, what we'll see is that he stops it really close to the edge. And what I like about this one is that he has his body a little bit more behind the ball, which in my view allows him a little bit more naturally to stop the ball. We can see that he has the reversed hands, one over top and one underneath. I personally prefer to have two on top, but I like this is a technique he chooses to do. And he stops it really in front, which makes it, if the ball goes through and it bounces through, he will get it on his feet, which is not ideal, but at least it won't go to the other half of the field and they got time to recover. So again, beautiful stop this. Absolutely one of the best I've seen online. Extremely close to the circle. It bounces a little bit off of his stick, and there's a good rhythm in between the stopper and the flicker. Here we see the Argentina girl again. In this technique, we see that she starts with one hand loose and she steps towards the ball. I'm not a big fan of this technique. It allows you a little bit more correction possibility, but it's not wrong either. Good stop, good rhythm. And then there's a hit. We're going into the drag flick, and I know I said that it's going to be 40 minutes. Looks like it's going to be an hour anyway. Sorry for that. When we get into the drag flick, then I'm going to show the drag flick manual we have as Philo Kilburna, which is available on the website. We'll go over the drag flick. But I would advise everyone to also go to the Philo Kilburna website and download the PDF form of the drag flick itself, so you have a little bit more time to go over it yourself if you're working on the drag flick. The drag flick has four key phases. It has the grip, the startup, the drag phase, the acceleration phase, and the swing phase. And we'll go over this relatively quick. Let's see some penalty corners.
Why wait to say, at least I did in my way. I wait to face, but in my heart I understand. I made my move, and it was all about you. Now I feel so far removed. You are the one thing in my way. 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 My way.
So what we see in this video is basically the same as what we see in injecting and in stopping the ball, is that there's different techniques possible. If we look at the technique here from the Malaysian player, what we'll see, and it's try to look at his feet, is that we see that his right foot, he steps out with his left foot now, and his right foot goes behind his left foot in order to make the step. So it's left, right goes behind left and stepping out with left again in order to make the shot. If we go to the Argentina corner, I hope we can see it. Oh, there's another shot. What we'll see here is that this is Gonzalo Pilot. He's one of the world's best drag flickers. He doesn't go behind, but his right foot goes over his left foot. So it's out with left. Right goes over and then steps out with left before he scores it. So there is, and this one's even different again. This is right behind left again. We'll see is that the player walks more in a straight line once he does the shot. And in the end, none of none of these techniques are wrong or right, or actually they're all right. Again, it's important that you use a technique that you're comfortable with. That said, there are some key points that are the same for every penalty corner. Starting with the grip. It's important to not force your hand, so you have a loose grip when you hold on to the stick. I've lost my cursor again. But what we can see in this picture is that the player has her right hand in the V grip. So the her thumb and index finger, that V is pointing towards the hook of her stick. And this particular player has her index finger behind the stick, which is fine. Some coaches are against it. Some coaches say it's good. It's more a technique used for dribbling. But in this picture, you see Maartje Pauwme, who was the world's best female drag clicker in the world, and she has her index finger behind the stick. So who am I to say, don't do it? The startup is how we run towards the ball or how we step towards the ball before we do the drag click. That can vary from 3 to 5 steps. Don't do more than 5 steps. It's about getting a rhythm. It's about making a forward movement. It is not like in soccer that you do a complete run up in order to kick the ball as hard as you can. It's mainly to get a rhythm, to do the timing, and to get your body into the right position. A longer run up will not allow a harder shot. So the first step you make is the correction step. So if the injector doesn't inject the ball perfectly, or the stopper stops it a little bit different, your first step is there to adjust your body to the new position of the ball. The second step is the step you turn in your body position and make sure your hips are sideways, because in the end it starts from a sideways position and it is a rotational position towards the net. Again, if you want to go over this with a little bit slower, the PDF form of the penalty corner is on the Field Hockey Alberta website. Step three, and this is again something where different coaches have different ideas. If you use the technique where your right foot goes behind your left foot, the moment you step your left foot near the ball, it needs to be 1 foot away from the ball. So you're really close to the ball. A common mistake is that people are too far away from the ball and cannot get power in the ball. Imagine if you are standing in front of someone and you want to push that person away. If that person is 1 meter away and you can only push that person away with your hands, you do not have a lot of power. However, if you're really close to that person, so you're really standing chest to chest, and then you're pushing that person away, you can really put a lot of power in your push and push that person all the way to the other side of the room. It's the same with the ball. If you want to push the ball towards net and you're too far away, you're reaching. And when you're reaching, it's really hard to get power in the ball. So with the technique where your right foot goes behind your left foot, you need to be in and about 1 foot away with the ball the moment you pick it up. If you're using the technique where your right foot crosses in front of your left foot, you can be 2 feet away. That's step three. And when we go into the acceleration phase, this is really the acceleration phase. It's not called the acceleration phase for nothing. So the first phase was to get the right technique, to get the right walk up, to make sure everything's in order. The moment we get into the acceleration phase, we really want to accelerate the ball. It's important, again, we stay close to the ball. And from this moment on, our body needs to be above our body weight, if that makes sense. So we cannot fall away from the ball, lean backwards, lean forwards. Our body weight is positioned centrally above our feet, if that's English. That moment we move through the ball, and it's really important. We can see that in the left bottom picture, and where we have the blue arrows. When we are in the acceleration phase, it's extremely important to pull the ball in a straight line. And you can practice this yourself by just simply putting tape on the field and or putting a stick on the field next to the ball. You want to make sure that the power goes straight into the ball and all the power is being pushed forward. If you have a curve in the flick while you're drag flicking, your energy first goes to the left or first goes to the right before it goes towards the net. So really important and really easy to check. When you're drag flicking, the ball needs to roll in a straight line. And the last one is the swing phase. Don't be afraid to fully rotate. We see on these pictures that the person is looking at the net when he shoots the ball. In my opinion, you don't need to see if you scored that goal. Make sure you do your technique all right. You make a full rotation. You put that full rotational power into the ball, because the moment you look up to the net, a lot of people stop their rotation. And if you score a goal, you'll hear your teammates anyway. So, and you can look at the goal back on video later, but make sure that you use the right technique. And don't look up too soon in order to see if you've scored. If there are people working on their drag flick and they are wondering if they can do, if they are doing it right, you can always send the video of your drag flick to me. I'll have a look at it and I'll give you some tips. A lot of questions that I often get around the drag flick is, when do I start training a drag flick? At what age? My personal opinion is that the age of 11 and 12 years old, you can already see if someone has the potential to drag flick. And at the age of 13, 14, you should start training some kind of a flick or some kind of a push. It does not mean that you're already doing the full drag flick technique, but maybe the second part of the technique where your stick is on the ball, you're pushing it forward and then try to push it towards the net. Don't start with how much balls do I shoot per practice? My belief is that you should never shoot more than 100 balls per hour. In the end, it's a technical movement and we can always build power in the gym. If you wanna make sure your technique gets better, you maximum shoot 100 balls per practice. The other thing is, don't always shoot the ball at the end of practice because you're already tired and you're going to mess up your technique. So either do it through the training or preferably organize drag flick training with your coach outside of the team training. Point three, how do I score high in the net? And I hear this question with hitting on net, with pushing on net, sweeping on net, drag flicking on net. How do I score high in the net? Yes, it's awesome to score a ball in that top corner. But in the end, winning is way more fun than that one beautiful goal. And make sure you practice your technique really good in the low right, low left bottom before you start aiming high. Because again, yes, those shots are beautiful, but if you start too early with just shooting them high, you're gonna mess up your technique because you're gonna change your technique in order to get the ball up. Are there any other questions regarding a drag flick that people wanna ask me right now? And I see someone is trying to send me a chat. However, when I use the share screen option, I cannot read the chat. So if you have a question, I'm sorry, you really gotta ask it in real life.
How do you know someone has the potential to drag flick? Like you said, you can like see it pretty early, but how do you know?
Well, in the end, it's a technique, so everyone can learn it. But What I look at in a player, and mainly in young players, when they do the drag click, I look if they do the wrist movement right, if they are flexible in their wrists and in their turning into the ball. So when people drag click, they often have the feeling that they need to face the net. So they their hips are, how you say that? So their hips are not turned into the net, but their hips are sideways. And then they push the ball away from them. If I look at a young kid and I see a natural movement in turning into the ball and the rotational movements, I'm often like, well, that kid has some potential. And like I said, the wrist movements, something that's really hard to learn is the snap, the flexibility in the wrists. Yes, everyone can learn that, but a good wrist hand wrist movement is at a young age shows potential in getting a drag flick later on. And you especially see that in indoors, when people at a young age have a good flick in indoors, they often have a good wrist movement. So there might be potential in the drag flick. Does that make sense?
Yep, thank you.
Any other questions regarding drag flick? No. Yes, there is a lot more drag flicking in men's field hockey, but please, for all the female players watching this seminar right now, specialize in the drag flick. If you can do a drag flick, that is a reason to select a player into a team. a little bit earlier, I talked about Maartje Pauw, who was has been best player of the world, and she had an extreme good drag flick, which made that she came into certain training environments and got some opportunities because of that drag flick, which made that she had the possibility to train up to her potential, and in the end became the best player of the world. I hope she's not going to hear this, but I think that without that drag flick, at a younger age, she might not have gotten the opportunities to train at that level in order to develop her full potential. So if you're not doing anything in the penalty corner, give it a try. The drag flick is an extremely important technique to learn. Where to score? We already talked about the top corner, right corner, and so this is this setup is something that's used a lot by coaches to indicate where to shoot. Just a guess, where do we think, which zone, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6, which zone are the most goals made? Anyone to guess?
4 and 6.
Sorry?
4 and 6.
4 and 6. Anyone else a different opinion? Well, Taylor, you're absolutely right. Most goals are made in zone 4 and 5, actually. But more than 2/3 out of all international penalty corners are made in zone 4, 5, and 6, and not in zone 1, 2, and 3. Do we have any idea why 4 and 5 are the zones where the most penalty corners are scored? No? It's a trick question. It's a hard question, and we'll, in a second, I'll explain it, why it's 4 and 5 and not 4 and 6. But it is 4, 5, and 6, but there's a decent amount of goals actually scored in zone 5. That said, it is important as a drag flicker that you are able to score in all corners. Again, at a young age, don't start too early with just shooting at area 1 and 3, but you got to be able to make a shot there. Because at a certain point, people are going to know where you shoot, and then it's going to be really hard to score. Why in international field hockey, why the goals are mainly made in zone 4 and 5 is because of this. So right here we see a penalty corner. I forgot which game it was. And White is trying to score in the net over here. And this is what happens a lot in international field hockey, is that the first two runners close off this side of the goal. There's an extra stopper on the left side of the defending penalty corner here. So the only area that is open is basically this zone, this shot over here. And what we also see, and it's not too much in this case, is that in a lot of games, because the first players are responsible for this side of the net, and the stopper here is responsible of this side for the net, the goalie makes a bigger step to the right so that he or she only covers this area. So this is the area that is often more open to shoot than the other side. So that's why there's more goals in zone 4 and 5 than there's actually in zone 4 and 6. However, it is important to be able to shoot in all corners of the net. So these are the stats of the penalty corners during the 2018 Champions Trophy. We'll see that Gonzalo Pela, what I talked about earlier, was probably the best drag flicker in the world. Scored five goals. He was top scorer with 6 goals during the tournament, and 5 out of those 6 goals came from different zones. So yes, most goals, as you can see, are made in the bottom and in the bottom left. However, as a drag flicker, you got to be able to score in all the zones in order to be really dangerous. Variations. My opinion, coaches go too soon to different variations. Things that are, I'm going to hurry up a little bit because we're short on time.
Hello?
Yes. Nora?
Nora? Das habe ich gehört. Das geht mir gut. Und dir?
Nora? Nora, your sound is on when you're on the phone.
Oh, missed.
Thank you, Nora. Attacking penalty corner, different variations. My opinion, a variation needs to be as good as your first corner. Play a variation because there's playable space, not because it's a fun corner and you trained it. Only play variations you train. Don't come up with a new variation halfway through the game. Play variations that fit your skills. If you don't have a player that can make a tip in from the right side, don't do a tip in from the right side. And what I think is really important is talk about the playable space in the circle. This is something that I use for Dinos and use for multiple teams. During the penalty corner, these are the zones that I indicate during our attacking penalty corners to see where the space is. So the blue top one is left low, the yellow one is right low, the red one is left high, right high. So I talk about with my players where the space is if we play a variation. And we've got shots from the top, shots from the left center, right center, and right side. This is something that I use when I coach. I'm not saying it's the only way or the only zones, but it makes it really visible for my players to see where the space is in the penalty corner. So, and this one's already, it's already shown in the animation. We'll see a penalty corner. I believe it's Belgium against Korea, but I could, Belgium against Korea. We'll see is a penalty corner. It's a flick from the top. And the person with the cursor here makes a tip in. And here we see from a little bit of a better angle. So the Korea is running out. And Korea does a pretty good job in defending the penalty corner, or they made a decision in how to defend the penalty corner. They have two players up high, as we can see. They have a player here in the net, which is relatively high outside the net. So this zone is closed off. The goalie is positioned more to the right in order to defend the goal, because he is responsible for this. And we see player number five boxing out the red player, which leaves the space here in the left low bottom. And Belgium, absolutely 100% sure, analyzed the defending penalty corner of Korea. And we see that this passing or shooting lane is open. Player comes in. Beautiful goal. Here we see it even better. We see that here where the yellow area is, the left low button is completely open for the player to play a variation in and tips the goal. Here we see another one. Question, where is the space right now? So we're having Holland against Argentina. Pull out, balls on the top. These zones are all blocked. Where is the space right now? Anyone a guess? What would you do? You were the coach.
Pass it to the left here, where there's three people waiting.
Okay, so what was the name of that zone?
That was, well, one's in the higher left and the other's in lower left.
Yeah, so you would say here or there?
Probably more higher.
High left. Well, you should be coaching the Dutch national team, because that's exactly what they do. Well, the other thing what we see what's good here is that this player, but then we go a little bit deeper into the analysis. So this is the corner you would play, Grant.
Yeah.
Yeah. So again, you should be coaching this team because that's the corner they're going to do. What I really like about this corner too is that they use the first stopper. The player over here runs across in order to block the view of the goalie and to slow down the first runner. So the first runner lost track of the ball. And like Grant said, ball will go to the left high position. Because that's where the space is, and has a free shot from that zone. Here we see clearly that the left high is open. Next one. What space is open? Because this space is closed off. There's one big goal possible right now, and there's two spaces open.
The two spaces are open are high left and high right, and I'd probably go high left.
Sorry, high left and?
And high right.
Yes.
I'd go high left.
Yeah, I think that high right is hard because these players are running.
Yeah.
I would potentially say maybe that left low is also open. But what we'll see here is that indeed left high is open. So they change the angle of the shot to that position and shoot it. Last thing, and I'm realizing I'm way over time, so I'll make it quick, is that it's important that everyone realizes that they have a role in the attacking penalty corner. As a coach, I think it's also your job to analyze, okay, if we make a certain shot, where is the ball going to end up? We see a game from the Netherlands here, Kampong against HGC. We see Blue is attacking the net. There's going to be a flick. And what we see real good here is that everyone knows that this person is going to shoot. So they're going to anticipate if the ball comes on the goalie, where can it end up? So it won't end up straight back to the middle, because that's where these two players were. So that's not where the shot is coming from. So the options for the rebound are these zones. We put some players in that space and we can score a goal. We see it again over here. They've chosen to do a shot. We see that there's players from white in that zone, and there's one hiding behind the goalie trying to be responsible for this zone. I think the white team analyzed that the shooter is shooting a lot in this zone. However, there are no rebounders from white on this side. So blue puts some players in this space on purpose because they know if the goalie delivers the ball to that area. So we're still going for the shot because that's the corner we decided. We see that the white area, there's no white player, so blue puts players in that space. That when the ball comes there, it's a goal. What have we talked about? One, train the penalty corner. Make sure you try to do it outside of training and not just in the end. My big tip for every player is become important in the penalty corner. And yes, we need drag flickers, but we don't need 16 drag flickers in a team. Make sure you're able to do something in the penalty corner. Make sure you're able to pull out. Make sure you're able to stop, to drag flick, or maybe you're a great tipper, but specialize in a specific part of the penalty corner. As a coach, when I make my selections, when someone is capable of doing something in the attacking penalty corner, that player certainly has an advantage over a player that cannot do anything in an attacking penalty corner. Analyze your opponent when you're doing an attacking penalty corner. Make sure that you know where the spaces are. Make sure that you train a rhythm. Pull, stop, flick, pull, stop, shot, pull, stop, pass, tip. Doesn't matter. It needs to be a rhythm. And the last thing is, and I especially hear that from parents a lot, so to all the parents that are listening to this seminar, I often hear, oh, we never score from the penalty corner. Realize that a penalty corner is only scored every 1 out of 3, 1 out of 4 times. So trust in the penalty corner you have, and don't change it up too soon. To end, I want to show a little bit of footage from Dinos last year to show how important the penalty corner can be, and not only how important the penalty corner can be, but even if you do everything wrong, you can score a goal. And even if you do everything right, there is a possibility you won't score a goal. So this is the last 2.5 minutes of our game against Juvik. And if you're a Juvik player, you probably want to look away now, because I can imagine you guys must have seen this over hundreds of times now. But what we'll see here is we were 2-0 down, 2.5 minutes before time. We score a goal with 2 minutes and 23 seconds to go on the clock. We go on the attack again. And what we'll see here is we are Team Red, we are Dinos, we play. We are on the attack here. Juvik is gonna get the ball in a second because we're doing everything to get the ball. Juvik is going to the corner with the ball. and dribbling, and we'll steal the ball. We will get a penalty corner with 1 minute and 8 seconds to go. We get a penalty corner. You can see that that's me on the sideline. My captain is coming towards me. Which penalty corner shall we do? And I believe I said something like, you know what, whatever, just get a shot off. Make sure the ball goes towards net. I don't care what you do. Make sure the ball goes on target. And in this penalty corner, we take a shot. I'm 100% sure this is not where my captain wanted to shoot the ball. I don't even know 100% sure if this is the corner they wanted to play, but they got the ball on the top. She shoots it through the legs of the goalie, and we tie it with 20 seconds to go. So this was as an example of a penalty corner where things don't go as planned. We still get the ball at net, and we score because we make that decision. So yes, a penalty corner, 1 out of 4, 1 out of 3, but always remember you can do everything right and not score a penalty corner, and you can get the most shitty shot off that you've done in your career, and it will maybe go through the legs and you'll score that tying goal in the last seconds. Thank you for listening today. I realized I'm way over time. Where I thought it was going to be 40 minutes, it turned out to be 70 minutes. So I'll try to do that better next time. Are there any questions right now or anything at all? There's no questions.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll stop recording.